Good morning. So I'm picturing each of you in your regular place, sitting here in the sanctuary, looking forward to that moment when we're going to be able to do that again. And I think everyone knows that because we really are trying to do everything in love, and we're really working to protect our most vulnerable people, that it's going to be a while before we can sit together in such an enclosed space. But we are working on a plan to be able to worship outdoors and on the porch and perhaps in the parking lot, and continue our online worship, and eventually in the hall where households can be spaced out, and in here. And last week during the Zoom meeting, the coffee hour after church, it was recommended that maybe there's a way for us to open the sanctuary or the space for people who just want to come and be here and pray. And we don't feel that's quite safe yet, but we're going to continue looking for ways to make those kinds of things happen. Because our sacred spaces, our physical spaces, are really important to us. I'm Pastor Jonathan Mays, the pastor of Greensky Hill Indian United Methodist Church. We want to welcome you to our Sunday morning worship service. We're going to gather together as if we were all in this physical space together, just down the road from our sacred trees and just over the hill in the woods from Susan Lake. And we're going to worship. First, just a couple really brief announcements. If you could leave a comment and note who's with you so that that's signing our registration book, then that helps us with our attendance records. Pastor Sarah's children's message is going to be included in the service this morning on Facebook Live, and those recordings, as you perhaps have been able to take advantage of, are always available after church at our greenskyhill.org website. And we have all the services since we started doing this Facebook Live series. And then there is a Zoom coffee hour. We added that last week. We had a congregational meeting on the 31st, and then we started Zoom coffee hour at 11 last week. And some folks had trouble joining. So on our Greensky Hill group Facebook page right now are some step-by-step instructions and a Word document. If you had trouble, I want to encourage you to go ahead and look for last week's invitation. Click on it after the service, or unless you have another device to check that. And it should open up the Zoom app, and you should see yourself on video, and it should invite you to join meeting. That's how it should work, and you're going to get a new invitation at 10:45 this morning. And I encourage you to go ahead and check on that. You can, you might be in the meeting by yourself or with other people for a few minutes while I get from here to home. But if you have trouble, please click on the Word document that gives you step-by-step instructions, especially with what to do with an iOS device. That's an Apple iPhone or iPad, because some folks had trouble with that. And let's worship. Let's ring the bell and worship. Built around the Gospel of Matthew, and the time when Jesus once again told all of his followers the paradigm of this world. To quote my friend Connie Kutzlib, who gave me some counsel about this passage, the paradigm needs to change, and it's not the paradigm of power, it's the paradigm of compassion. And as we watch the world still busting loose to say, our systems are broken, and black lives haven't mattered the way that they really do matter, and we need to acknowledge that. it's especially important for us to know our role as the people of God in bringing a paradigm of compassion into the world. So I'm going to invite you, Jesus, in this story this morning, sends the disciples out into the world to do the things that he was doing, and he invites us to respond. So we're going to sing a song that I think most of you know. I did put the words in the order of service online this morning. I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright, who will bear my light to them, whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord, is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, if you lead me, I will hold your people in my heart. I, the Lord of snow and rain, I have borne my people's pain, I have wept. I will tend the poor and lame. I will set a feast for them, whom my hand will save. Finest bread I will provide, till my heart be satisfied. I will give my life to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? Sermon this morning is comparing 2,000 years ago to the 60s here in the United States and to what's going on right now. And seeing the ways things haven't changed and the ways things have changed and asking ourselves, what can we do about it? And especially, what can the church do about it? In order to get there, we love to pray together. And when we pray together, it's not so much as some Christian faiths teach or some religions teach that we get to tell God what to do. It's that we get to say yes. We get to listen. We get to bring our needs and our concerns and our worries and our joys and share them with God and with one another. And this time of prayer is a time of connection. And so let's open with the grandfather prayer. And then we'll pray together silently. Feel free to share your prayer concerns with others in the comment section as we pray. I won't see them till later, but the Spirit knows, and as I light candles, I'm lighting them for you and for all the things that you name, either by typing them into the comments or just saying them in your home or saying them in your heart. Naamaadaa. Grandfather, look at our brokenness. We know that in all creation, only the human family has strayed from the sacred way. We know that we are the ones who are divided, and we are the ones who must come back together to walk the sacred way. Grandfather, Sacred One, teach us love, compassion, and honor, that we may heal the earth and heal each other.
Thank you. Lord, hear our prayer.
The Lord's Prayer. Nous nam stimmig ein. Manuta chitoin jade kishnikas. Dugmau in the betrustum get an end when the shuabat a ma king. Dvishko udishpin. Mishanam sunugagishka again jang. Gye avoid mishnam when batage. Amen.
I've heard from many of you how hearing Jay's voice from this sanctuary brings you peace and comfort, and it touches childhood memories. And I've heard from just as many who never had a chance to meet Jay or know Jay or his kids as I do, who are touched by listening to him pray in Anishinaabemowin. And I'll tell you what I miss. I miss Braid and Greensky leading that prayer. He started when he was about this tall, and I can't wait to hear him in this congregation leading that again. At this time, we get to bring Sarah Schaefer on line and hear our children's message. So I'm going to invite Sarah.
Good morning.
Good morning.
This morning in our message coming from Matthew, Jesus tells his disciples that the harvest is huge, but they only have a few workers. And he tells them that God needs to send workers into the field. And when he said this, Jesus wasn't only talking about disciples, he was also talking about us. And Jesus needing each of us to see all of the people in our lives and show them Jesus's love. So it made me think about show and tell in school, and I'm sure we all remember doing this. And even as adults, we kind of have our own show and tell in a way when we get something new or we want to share something with a family, something exciting. But when you do show and tell, you bring something to school and you show the whole class, and you're so excited, but you also tell them about it. So show and tell wouldn't really work if you just showed them and didn't tell them about it, or if you told them about something and didn't have anything to show. So they kind of go hand in hand. You want to show and tell. Well, it's the same thing when we are showing Jesus's love to somebody. We can't just tell them that Jesus loves them. We also want to show them. And when you are looking in a mirror, I've got a mirror here that I just kind of use in the morning, and I'll fix my makeup or maybe, you know, fix my hair and, you know, just kind of check and make sure that I know what my reflection is. And people use mirrors every day. And when you look into a mirror, it gives you a reflection of what you look like. So to tell somebody about Jesus, you have to show them what Jesus looks like. But we can't just reach up and grab Jesus and say, here he is, look, this is what he looks like. So when you see someone who needs Jesus, you show that person Jesus by acting the way that he has taught us to act. So, for example, if you're in the grocery store and somebody, you know, goes to put their, was on their phone and looking at their grocery list, or they put it back in their purse and they go to turn the corner and their phone falls out onto the floor. If you go over and pick it up and get their attention and hand it back to them, you know, that's something that Jesus would do. And if you look in the mirror after you do those sorts of things, then you would see the face of Jesus. And so, you know, there's certainly lots of examples, things that you could do. I know that some people will find a wallet that's happened actually in our lives as well. And there might be cash in it. And it also has somebody's driver's license. So you know whose wallet it is. And you know you're going to get it back to them because that's the right thing to do. Some people might take the cash out and toss the wallet. It's not the right thing to do. You know, if you were to give the person back their wallet fully intact, you know that you could go home and look in the mirror and you could also see Jesus when you looked in the mirror. So there's lots of ways that we can show Jesus's love by compassion, by empathy, by standing for others, by being the voice of the unheard. We can do simple things every day in our own lives, but it's really important for us to not just tell people about Jesus, but also to show them. And it kind of reminded me of when I was younger and the What Would Jesus Do bracelets came out. And it was simply a bracelet that said WWJD. And it was a reminder to always do what Jesus would do. And I'm really bummed that I don't see those around as much anymore, because I think they're just a really, really great reminder. But when you see people around you, just remember that they all need to know about Jesus's love. Just like Jesus tells us in this verse of the scripture, God needs helpers to show and tell the world how much Jesus loves them. And I think that we could all be great workers for God. And when you tell your friends about Jesus, or if you show your friends about Jesus, you're helping to bring the harvest. So I hope that this has resonated with you this morning, and that we can always remember to put on our best face and always do, not just say, you know, that we're Christians and that we, the things that we believe, our actions. I hope you guys have a great week. I will see you next week. Love you all. Bye-bye.
Love you too, Sarah, and it sure resonated with me this morning. Thank you.
You're welcome.
It reminds me of an old friend of mine who used to say, you may be the only Jesus that some people ever see. To give thanks in both prayer and by singing the doxology in the Nuhguhmowinum. With hearts full of thanksgiving, we share our gifts. Holy God, we marvel at your love for all your creation. When Jesus saw the crowds that gathered, he had compassion on them. The church that bears the name of Christ must always remember we were born out of compassion. We offer our gifts to continue the work of compassion, but more than this, we offer ourselves, as Jesus also commanded us to go. In his holy name, We pray. Amen. Will you sing with me one of our favorites, Oh, How Happy? A lot going on in the world. Most of it has been going on from the beginning, after the creation that the Creator made good. And we talked about that a lot last week. Us two-leggeds just keep trying to pollute that good and turn it into something that's not good. And so we're looking at the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 9, verses 35 through chapter 10, verse 23. And we're going to use a song from the 60s, a Buffalo Springfield song that people my age and older, probably many of you will remember. I think it came out in 1967, although many of our members and friends were born after that. But I think it's an apropos song for this week in the world, especially around our nation, and solidarity around the globe after the murder of George Floyd. It just brought to the surface what Caitlin Curtis, in her book, Native. Caitlin is going to be our keynote speaker at Camp Meeting 2021. She was coming this year, and we rescheduled it, so thankfully she's going to be able to join us in August, the first weekend of August next year. She came out with a new book called Native: Identity, Belonging, and Rediscovering God. And one of the things, one of her chapters is called The Problem of Whiteness. If you're white like me, just let go of your fragility for a minute and let's listen. A big part of what the text tells us today is that the hospitality of being the guest instead of the host is one of the most important ways to bring about the compassion, the paradigm of compassion that Jesus created or reinforced or returned to creation when he came to build his wigwam among us. And in her chapter, The Problem of Whiteness, Caitlin talks about how underneath all of the surface stuff is a huge problem. And here's how she describes it. On Earth Day in 2018, it rained most of the afternoon. During a lull in the dreary weather, I went outside to check on our garden. I had planted seeds a month earlier and nothing came up, probably because the soil had hardened during an earlier week-long storm. In order for my tomatoes, broccoli, and sugar snap peas to grow, I needed to till up the ground again, add some compost, and pull up weeds. I grabbed my hand tiller, one of those that you stand on, push into the ground, and turn into the dirt so that it pulls up weeds along with it. I stood at the corner of the garden, hitting the same patch of ground over and over again, and eventually mumbled to myself, "There's something going on down there." I knew then and there that the dirt represented deeper issues that were preventing growth. And she goes on to talk about this current era and our leadership and what's happening in the world. And she eventually brings it both from our political leadership into our church and the history of the problem of whiteness in the church. And she asked this question: how can the white American church, with a history of complicity and abuse toward indigenous peoples, ask any questions about the nature of God if we cannot ask ourselves to take an honest look at our own intentions? And she asked a few other hard questions. She talks about ways in which some of our leadership have tried to be allies, but even in their efforts to be allies, they've done more harm. But she asks this important question to us: she says, white supremacy within our politics and within our churches should be addressed on a number of levels. But if we cannot admit that we have a problem in the first place, nothing will ever change. And finally, it's a beautiful chapter, and the book is important, and I hope you do get it. It'll be the focus of our camp meeting next year. But she asked us, what happens when white supremacy taints our Christianity so much that we would rather scream the love of God over someone than honor and respect their rights to live peacefully within the communities they have created and maintained for generations? If Christianity is able to decenter itself enough to see the imprint of sacred mystery already belongs all over the earth to all peoples, it would change the way we treat our human and non-human kin. And there's so much more that I'll be sharing from Caitlin's book, but I'll leave most of it for her to share face-to-face, because she's going to do a much better job, and it's going to be a powerful time for us to hear from her together. Our scripture today takes us to a time when Jesus and his first followers faced much of what the church still faces, and especially indigenous people in the church and its power systems that are so deeply rooted in other historic power cultures that it's hard to even see the difference between the enculturation of white supremacy and biblical Christianity. And it's very uncomfortable for people to talk about. I got comfortable talking about it a while ago, and I'm sure I've lost a few friends, especially Facebook friends. But as the pastor of an indigenous church where people long before European Christians came to this world, this part of the world, and told people about Jesus, the people that were here already knew the Creator and already knew the path to walk the sacred way. So when folks learned the name of this Creator, the one who came and built a wigwam among us. It was no surprise to them. And here at Greensky Hill, we celebrate the beautiful reality that the traditional ways are completely consistent with the teaching of Jesus. And here's one way that you'll hear that. All the way up to the ninth chapter of Matthew, here in this gospel, what Jesus has been doing is traveling around, walking gathering crowds everywhere he went, because he kept giving life to people, literally giving life, food, healing, wholeness, freedom from oppression, freedom from spiritual oppression and psychological concerns and issues. And that naturally gathered a crowd of people, and it naturally really angered the powers that were. The power system of the Roman government and the religious system that was complicit with that government. And then he came to this point where he, as Sarah mentioned this morning, noted that he was, even though he's God in the flesh, he was only one man on earth, and he needed more workers. He needed more harvesters. The harvest is plenty, but the workers are few, as Sarah talked about this morning. And so he said this, to these things to his disciples. And I'm going to read half of the reading, sing half of the Buffalo Springfield song, and then read the second half of the reading and close with the rest of the Buffalo Springfield song. If you know it, sing with me. And I hope you can make the connections between the world that Jesus lived in 2,000 plus years ago, the world that I grew up in the 60s, and the world that we live in right now. I do note one beautiful change from the 60s to these last couple weeks, and it was former President Obama who first pointed out this wonderful difference, although it was quite obvious. All you had to do was look at the crowd. It's not just BIPOC, it's not just Black, Indigenous people of color who are rising up to say enough is enough. Allies from every race and age and identity have risen up to say, enough is enough. And Jesus was doing this in a way that is very hard for us to understand unless you stop for a minute and think, what was the paradigm then? What is the primary paradigm now? As my friend Connie Kussel noted, what is the paradigm change that Jesus initiated when he said the kingdom of God is at hand? And I'm purposefully changing kingdom, which is patriarchal and monarchical and in so many ways an image that isn't helpful anymore, to kingdom. When Jesus said the kingdom of God is near, he was saying the paradigm has changed. And one of the ways that he did that was healthcare for all. Listen to what he did. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. I'm just going to pause this one time before I read the rest of the text and sing the song, because I want you to, if you can, where you are in your space, and if you need to close your eyes to do it, go ahead. Your family won't think you're weird, or they already know you're weird. Put yourself in this place. Put yourself in a world where there wasn't help, public health care. And then put yourself in the 60s, in the inner cities, where especially if you were a person of color, the resources available to you were just not the same as the ones available to other people. And then put yourself in today. And as you hear each part of the story, try to walk that time travel from Jesus' time to the 60s to now, and ask God to change the paradigm in you, so that we together can change the paradigm in the world. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, for they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First time and only time in the book of Matthew that the disciples are called apostles, which means sent ones, apostles, us. First, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James, the son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the Cananean, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no towns of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost house, the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You received without payment, give without payment. Why this radically welcoming Jesus? Why would he tell his disciples first to start with just their own people and not the rest of the world yet? Although by the end of this gospel, it becomes clear that God has sent all of us into all of the world to bless all of the world and to heal all these broken relationships. Talking with Connie helped me make sense of that, that those were the people, the lost sheep of Israel, were the people who just didn't feel like they were enough. They weren't good enough. They weren't doing it right. They didn't have enough money to pay for the temple sacrifices. They weren't good at memorizing the Torah. That whatever it was, these were the people, and I think this is good insight, that didn't feel enough. And Jesus wanted them to know, I am with you, and you are enough. There's something happening. Something happening here. What it is ain't exactly clear. There's a man with a gun over there telling me I've got to beware. I think it's time we stop, children. What's that? Some people speak in their minds, getting so much resistance from behind. It's time we stop. Hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. What a field day for the need. Songs and a carrying signs, mostly saying hooray for our side. Please help me stop. Hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. Paranoia strikes deep to your life, it will creep. It starts when you're always afraid. Step out of line, the man come and take you away. You better stop. Hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going. Better stop. Hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going. Better stop. Hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. Wasn't sure I would ever have a chance to use a Buffalo Springfield song in a sermon, but here's the rest of the story. And again, placing ourselves with Jesus a couple thousand years ago, with the people on the streets in the 60s and the people on the streets now. Take no gold or silver or copper in your belts, no bag for your journey, or two tunics or sandals or a staff, for laborers deserve their food. Whatever town or village you enter, find out who in it is worthy and stay there until you leave. As you enter the house, greet it. If the house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it is not worthy, let your peace return to you. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, shake off the dust from your feet as you leave that house or town. Truly, I tell you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah on that day of judgment than for that town. See, I'm sending you out like sheep into the midst of wolves. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Beware of them, for they will hand you over to councils and flog you in their synagogues, and you will be dragged before governors and kings because of me as a testimony to them and to the Gentiles when they hand you over. When the law and order comes raining down, when the powers that be decide the military might is more important than listening, do not worry about how you are to speak or what you are to say, for what you are to say will be given to you at that time. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Brother will betray brother to death, and a father his child, and children will rise against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all because of my name. But the one who endures to the end will be made whole, will be saved. That beautiful Greek word, so-so. When they persecute you in one town, flee to the next. For truly I tell you, you will not have gone through all the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. I hope this week you think a lot about the connections between that time and now, between the uprisings in the world before that said, there are people who are being used by other people, and we need to stop that from happening. And I hope we see together that this idea that power and might and law and order are going to make things right in the world is wrong. It's just broken. It's the original sin of this world that one race has more power and authority over everybody else. And Jesus is saying, the paradigm of my kingdom is not the same as the paradigm of the world. The kingdom of Christ is a kingdom of compassion. Compassion where the power, instead of coming in to fix things and coming in to tell everybody what they need to do to be like us so that you can succeed in this world, is the guest who doesn't bring anything and depends on the other people to listen, to live, to be fed, to grow, to learn. And when we practice that kind of compassion in our race relations, the world will change. When we practice the compassion of the true humanity and the true church of Jesus Christ, the world will change. It's going to take all of us. The harvest is plentiful, the workers are few, and we need each other. I need you. You need me. We're all a part of God's body. Stand with me. Agree with me. We're all a part of God's body. It is God's will that every need be supplied. You are important to me. I need you to survive. You are important to me. I need you to survive. The last verse of this text confused me because Jesus, in the way that others have taught, hasn't come back into this world yet. So what did he mean? When they persecute you in one town, flee to the next, for truly I tell you, you will not have gone through all the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. And it was my friend Ken who reminded me that that phrase in Hebrew, Son of Man, instead of Son of God, reminds us of the full humanity of Jesus. And I think what he meant is that until the world sees my humanity in you, the world won't become this place of compassion that God created. And if you do these things, if you go and depend on others instead of bringing your answers to others, if you practice the hospitality of being the guest instead of the host, the full humanity, the true humanity of Jesus will be seen before you even get through all these villages. I pray for you, you pray for me. I love you, I need you to survive. I won't harm you with words from my mouth. I love you, I need you to survive. I need you to survive. It is God's will that every need be supplied. You are important to me. I need you to survive. You are important to me. I need you to survive. I love you. Go in peace to love and serve as Jesus loves and serves. And if you can, join us for the Zoom coffee hour in about 10 minutes. I'm going to race home. If you beat me there, that's fine. Right now, you should have an invitation with a link to click on. If you click on the icon, that should open a window where you'll see that it's opening the Zoom app. If you haven't downloaded the Zoom app, it will give you the opportunity to do that and then open that window for you. If you're using an iPhone or iPad, you might need to type in the meeting number and the password, and that information is also in the same invitation. And if you're having trouble with any of that, please follow the step-by-step guidance that you'll find on our Facebook page. Go in peace.